to everyone in South Korea, and thank you so much for the invitation. So my name is Michel Baus, as I said. I'm from Belgium. I live in northern Thailand, and I am the founder of the P2P Foundation, which is an observatory of these commons-based practices. So, okay, what do we mean? That's the first important question. So imagine how you can exchange some goods and services with your neighbors and friends and other people. So the first option might be what we call the gift economy. I give you something, and somehow that creates in your mind an obligation to return the gift at some other time. So you're thankful that I gave you something, and in order to restore kind of the equality between us, you're going to give me something back. So that was the basis of, you know, many thousands of years of society. And the second form is through what we could call the state. So there's a society, there's a government, the government taxes people and decides that people deserve a pension or healthcare, and so you're going to get what you need through this distribution system that is organized by public authorities. That's the second one. The third one is the one that everybody knows today, which is really dominant, which is, you know, just exchange goods for pricing. Like this costs so much, you make a choice what you can afford, what you need, and so this is the basis of the market. But there is a fourth one, which is very, very important historically, and that's what we call the commons. So the best way to understand the commons is to think about pooling resources, mutualizing resources, so putting things together in a whole. For example, people in a neighborhood could decide to share cars. There are studies that show that one shared car can replace between 9 and 13 individual cars. When oil become expensive or cars becoming too expensive, that might be an interesting option is to say, okay, let's buy something together and then find a way to share it between the group. So that basically is very simply what a commons is. And it has three criteria. So the first one is it's a shared resource. That's what I try to explain, right? So a shared resource can be anything that you can touch, but it can also be things like knowledge, like creating a collective knowledge on the internet, for example, to creating a Wikipedia or free software. But it can also be shared mobility, shared housing, all these kinds of things. The second criteria is that it's maintained by a community. So there's a group of people decide we need this, we're going to manage this ourselves. So that means it's not states, it's not a public authority that takes care of that resource, but it's also not the market, it's not private property. It's more a form of collective or common property, but freely decided between a number of people. And the third criteria to make us talk about commons is that we manage it ourselves. So those three things are important. It has to be something real and concrete. It's a decision by a community that has to do the work, as it were, to maintain that resource. And the rules are decided by the people who are involved in the project. So why is this so important? Historically, if you look at, for example, the state of nature, the state of resources, like why are the mountains so beautiful in Japan, in Austria, in Switzerland? It's because these mountain flanks there are maintained by the villagers. They have rules that make sure that the quality of this mountain flank, the greenery, the fruit, the nuts, whatever is there, is actually maintained for many, many generations in the future. So historically, the commons has been absolutely vital to maintain resources. And this is, of course, something that is not working well right now in the market system we have, is that we are vastly overusing resources. Now, people who have some kind of green sensibility would tell you that you can't just talk about, you know, humans separate from resources. There, that, you know, you can't treat living beings as a thing. And I'm quite sympathetic to that point of view. So can we do something about it and adapt our definition of the commons to it? Yeah, probably to expanding our notion of community. So considering that, you know, what we need to survive together, not just humanity, but all living beings, requires some kind of agreement. I know it sounds a bit strange, but with, you know, living beings, like we need the bees, we need domestic animals, we need many, many living beings to work with us in order to maintain our resource. So that's something we can do now, is to expand our notion of community. Now, I want to add the second concept that I wanted to explain, which is peer-to-peer. Why do we talk about peer-to-peer? And how is this related to the commons? The word peer-to-peer comes from computer systems. And so, I don't know if you're aware of this, 10, 15 years ago, we invented something called file sharing, peer-to-peer file sharing. And that meant that if you had a piece of music, a book, anything, you could basically start sharing it with everyone without passing through a central computer. So computers became peers. From peer to peer, any computer could communicate directly with any other computer. And basically the internet is based on that principle. So expand that to the idea of people. So once we have a technology like that, we can share and exchange, not just locally, between people, let's say in a village, who know and trust each other. That's the way we used to do it, let's say 5,000 years ago, and still done, of course, in many places. But now we can do it on a vast scale, because we can do virtual cooperation. And what that means is, I can now work on a project with somebody in Korea, in Japan, in Latin America. It doesn't really matter. So you take today a very complicated system like something called Linux, which is an alternative to Windows and Apple. Well, that's done by, you know, maybe 20,000 people in the world, and the average team is only 4 people. So how does this relate to commoning? Well, what we can now do is create commons on a vast global scale. And it doesn't replace the local, so we talk in the P2P Foundation about Cosmo Local. So the rule that we propose is that everything that is light, immaterial, so ideas, science, technology, can be global and shared. And everything that's heavy should be actually done as local as we can in terms of sustainability. I don't know if you know this, but we spend 3 times as much on transporting things and on making them. So making them closer to human needs is one of the ways that we're going to find to lower what we call the footprint of humanity on nature. And so the shift that comes by combining, you know, this vast capability of peering with each other, that means a shift in human culture towards open collaborative systems. So imagine playing football. So each team works together, so it's really based on cooperation. But every team fights any other team. You have to win the competition. Now, even in that kind of environment, you would still need rules, right? So if you play football or soccer, there's rules. Those rules are really the commons of the football game. So you have competition, but you always have also cooperation and commons that make the competition possible. And what I think is happening today is basically kind of a shift from these closed entities where you only know what's happening in your team, and there's really no common knowledge except for these rules that you agreed on together, to a situation where all the people in all the teams can see what they are doing, right? And this is a very important shift towards what I would call open collaborative systems. Imagine this, and I will stop with this. What if 50 companies, 100 companies coalesce together and say, well, we all need to do this in order to survive and thrive. But actually, why are we doing this all separately? We would save a lot of money, a lot of investment, if you would do it together. So that then becomes an entrepreneurial coalition, an alliance of entrepreneurs, of companies, of co-ops, whatever it is, NGOs, that together create a common resource that they're all dependent on. And so they will use, develop, and protect that resource that is useful for everybody. And that kind of also changes the way we can cooperate as humanity. I think that is what is we're watching today as society evolves to a potential next stage. So, in short, why is this so useful, the commons? So historically, the only human institution that has been able to preserve resources over the long term. So it's environmentally very important. It lowers the footprint, what we use in terms of matter and energy. Second, if you use a lot less matter and energy, it means it's a lot cheaper. So that means more inclusive socially. More people get access to these resources as we mutualize them. And the third step is learning to govern ourselves, right? Today, if you go to school, if you go to work, chances are that you don't have that much of a say, that you're following somebody else's agenda. And then we're supposed to vote every so many years. So that's a kind of a very weak form of self-governance. Once you enter into a commons arrangement, that community becomes collectively responsible for managing that resource. So it's really a school of, it's an education into democracy. So that's basically the story. So you have the commons and you have peer-to-peer. And today peer-to-peer is a way, a new way to create commons at a vast scale. And it's kind of something that we're going to need, one, to save resources and save basically our planet. And secondly, it has advantages in terms of equity, etc. So this is not a plea to say we only need to do commoning and we need to forget about the other modalities that I explained at the beginning, the gift economy, the state and the market, they have their place. But I do think that we have to work now to institutionalize the commons, to give a voice to these human communities and to these extra human communities that create these kind of collective resources for humanity. Thank you so much.